You see, if we don't grow or move ahead, we're going to get stagnant. You know, the other day, Lynn and I were out, and it was really, really hot. So we rode to Williamston, and we went to the DQ, and we got some ice cream, and the ice cream had caught my mustache. Then we got out in the sun, and I forgot I had a son would come back in. She went to kiss me. She says, "You smell funny." I said, "Excuse me?" She says, "You smell funny." I said, "I've been with you the whole time." She said, "But something." I said, "Oh, that's the ice cream. The sun guy." She goes, oh. You know what? Sometimes you're around people thinking they're smelling funny, and it's actually you. Because you got stagnant. Oh, I'm telling you, this is good stuff. This is worth the price of admission twice. Sometimes you're thinking they're stinking, and it's you. Because you've grown stagnant, because you're stuck. Amen? So watch. If one takes, if we're going to change our circumstances, go to our faith. There it goes. I'm hurrying up, because we got an RT to go. Everybody knows what RT means. We've got to go speed up. RTs. I need to refocus my thoughts if I want to change my life. Proverbs 24 and 23 says, "Keep vigilant watch over your heart." That's where life starts. Amen? We're moving on quickly. Are you ready? You got to stop making excuses. If you want to start, stop making excuses. Take an inventory of your life. Act in faith. Refocus yourself. And then you got to trust God with the circumstances. You see, you have to trust God to be able to succeed. If it had been my, if it had been me, I would have never gotten that big cat, that little cage, that big woman. No. I'm talking about WWF wrestler being. I thought she was going to kill me. If it had been my choice, I would have not been up there. I'd have been down on the ground somewhere where I could send her back and forth if I had to work with her. If I had my choice, I'd be working with somebody else. But the Lord fixed it that day because actually it actually come to a head because she just kept on and she would ridicule and she would burst the bubble and she would give me some of the sorriest assignments. And I don't know, other than just the God in me was just tearing her up because I didn't do anything to the woman at all. Nothing. But the Lord that day in that cage, 30 foot in the air for 8 hours, maybe 10 hours, changed the whole situation. You see, you got to trust God. You have to depend on Him. You have to depend on Him. If you're going through something, you're trying to start again, you can't depend on yourself. Because I'll get up and start moving and go, "Well, I remember what they did to me." No. "Well, it'd be a whole lot easier just to sit here and be mad." No. "Well, can we do it tomorrow?" No. "Well, maybe some other time." No. "Well, when I think it, when it's a little better." No. If God's told you to start moving forward, you ain't got to take it all at one time. You just got to do it. Remember the story about the preacher? I'll make it real short. The story about the preacher came in, it snowed really, really bad. He goes to the church, and there's only one person in the congregation, just one, no farmer. He says, "Well, it snowed too deep. Nobody else will come to church tonight, today." He says, "So let's just go on home." And the farmer said, "Hold on, preacher, hold on." Said, "If I go to feed my cows, only one shows up to the fence. I don't go back home. I still feed them." He goes, "Okay, you've convicted me. Go ahead and sit down." And so the preacher started preaching. He preached and 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 he preached again. When he got through, he walked back to the back, shaking the man's hand, and said, "Well, how'd you like that, son?" He said, "You never let me finish telling you my story." He said, "If I go to feed my cows, only one shows up at the fence." He says, "I don't feed them the whole load at one time." Which I just did, right? From the funny section over there, the pit detention section over there. Y'all ought to see how your pastor gets abused by those guys.
We were just wondering if that was a personal experience.
Yeah, like the time, like the time that guy said, that time I went up there, and they were trying to find, that time I went up there, and when I got ready to leave, the guy kept talking junk to me, the prisoner, and he told me, he said, come on up here with your big old Bugs Bunny teeth. He says, your Bugs Bunny teeth self? He said, come on up here and talk to me. And so he was really, really obnoxious. And so I'm getting ready to leave. And he said, well, come back here, Bugs Bunny. And so we're going out, and we're on the way to Krispy Kreme. And they said, well, did you have any problems? I said, yeah. And this one guy kept calling Bugs Bunny, but I don't want to hear it again, okay? Y'all, I hadn't heard it enough tonight. I don't want to hear it again, my old Bugs Bunny teeth looking self. They said, okay, you won't hear it again. We promise. I come around the corner, and there's Frank. I come around the corner, Frank had two straws. He went, where are we going to sit, Pastor? That was hilarious that night. But we have a lot of fun. We really do. All right. So look, you can't depend on yourself alone, because that's why we fail. Many times we fail because we do it ourselves. You've got to let God help us. Here it goes. Here's the last slide. Look at it a little bit. Y'all read it out loud. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let's try not to mess it up. That'd be a good song. Praise and worship song. You can mess it up. If you never start. Mess it up. Okay. All right. Well, I see it. He said in the past. Here's the last slide, I promise. Three things you can do with mistakes and hurts. By how many mistakes that I made, by how many hurts that I made, by how many I'm paying for mistakes somebody else made, and by how many I'm paying for hurts that somebody hurt me. So here it is. By how many are my mistakes and hurts, by how many mistakes and hurts that somebody else would still hurt me. Here's the three things we do. I put this last because I want to make sure this stays in your head. Ready? Number one, this is what most people do. What's this? Resolve to never make another mistake or be hurt again. I tell you what, I'll never make another mistake. I'll never do that again. How many ever said that? I'll never do that again. Or, one thing about it, they won't hurt me again. Anybody ever said that? Or they won't hurt me again, I guarantee you. They won't hurt me again. Guess what? That's impossible. Because you are going to do it again, and somebody else is going to hurt you again. So when you get that in your mind, get that mindset, all it does is separate you from people. It separates you from people, it separates you from potential. Because you're saying, I'm not going to do that again, or I'm not going to get hurt again. Resolve. Number two, retreat. Let mistakes and hurts make a coward out of you. There's a lot of people in church that would do a lot more if they could just get past that. Well, I made a mistake last time I tried it. Nobody, you know, I didn't mean for it to be that way. I had no idea this was going to happen. We were there and I kept telling the praise team, we're in Williams, the Church of God, I kept telling the praise team, fellas, it's not your job to get the people to worship. Your job is not their response. Your job is to lead them in worship. Their response is between them and God. And so, depending on who was leading, sometimes if they didn't get the response they wanted, they would just keep on going and keep on going. And one day, I think we went 30 minutes because the guy didn't get the response that he was looking for. And so, after service, I said, can I talk to you for a minute? He said, sure. He and his wife came in. And they sat down in my office and said, do you remember what I told you? That this is praise and worship, and your job in praise and worship is to lead people in praise and worship. And this is a mistake a lot of us make many times. Even pastors make it when they're preaching. They think they are responsible for the response. He said, yeah, I remember you telling me that, Pastor. I said, I'll tell you that just about every week, don't I? He said, yeah. I said, well, today I watched you get frustrated in praise and worship, which that did not encourage anybody to praise and worship because you got frustrated. And you actually fussed at the crowd because they weren't responding, and then you just wouldn't stop. he said something like, but, and I said, there's no buts about it. Your job is to lead. That's all. God takes care of everything else. The people responding to God, it's them, not you. And that guy, I told him this 100 times, but that day, he got mad. I wasn't fussing. I wasn't talking out of turn. I wasn't doing like I'm doing right now. He got up and walked out. And I didn't see him again for several weeks. I finally got a chance to contact him. And I said, what is going on, man? I said, we weren't fussing. We weren't having any problems. I was just trying to explain to you what we're doing. He said, I know. He said, but what the problem was, Pastor, it's my fault. He said, not yours. He said, when I walked out, I was thinking it was your fault, making excuses. He said, but as I started thinking about it, I began to realize you were right. As you've told me again and again and again. He said, and I just wore my feelings on my sleeve. Feelings, don't go by your feelings. And he said, and I was really trying to get people to respond to what we were doing. And I said, see, you're just worshiping God. That's it. He said, I realize that now. And he said, Pastor, will you please forgive me? I said, I forgave you when it happened. And he said, well, you didn't kick me off the team, or I said, no. I said, especially if you've learned this lesson, no. He said, okay. He said, I'm ready to get back up. I said, okay, that's fine. Now that you got it all worked out, you and God got it all worked out. He said, we got it all worked out. I said, cool. You see, what happened to him was he retreated. It didn't make a coward out of him. It made him mad. But he didn't realize when he got mad that it still made him retreat to the point where he weren't even been able to be used anymore. And once he thought about it, watch this. This is what he did. Rebound. Here's your choice. You can resolve. I'm never going to make a mistake again. I'm never going to be hurt again. You can retreat and say, which is kind of similar to resolve. And then, or you can rebound. Learn from your mistakes. Move beyond your hurts. Keep going. That's where we need to be. That's what we have to do. That's what we have to do. PJ, can you come on up this way? Here it is. I love this from last week. Little friendly reminder. The past is all what and is and always will be the past. Forever. You can't change it. A couple of good old quotes here. You can't change the past on what you should have done, but you can change the present and future on what you do and what you will do. Here's those little quotes. I love these little quotes. Shake the dust from your past and move forward with this promise, K. Arthur. Leave the broken, irreversible past in God's hands and step out into the invincible future with Him. Oswald Chambers. We can't just put our past behind us. We've got to put our past in front of God. There's the difference. You've got to put it behind you, but put it in front of God. The Lord says, forget what happened before and do not think about the past. Look at the new thing I'm going to do. It's already happened. Don't you see it? I'll make a road in the desert and rivers in the dry land. Isaiah 43:18.